everybody. Today I've wrapped up a project. It's a Curtis Mathes HiFi system from about 1959. Pretty sure this is a prototype, one-off that they made to test a design, this aesthetic here with the radio in the center. And interestingly, the phonograph on this side under this lid. Yeah, the controls for the phonograph are over here. We'll get into that a little more later. This came to me through a former classmate of mine from high school who contacted me after her husband picked this up at an estate sale, and it had some problems. It really wasn't working very well. She asked if I could fix it for them. I was able to, despite the fact that there were no schematics anywhere that I could find for this thing. And it was an interesting project. I'm going to tell you a little more about it. Here you can see the back side of the unit, including six speakers, two woofers, two mid-range, and two tweeters. And this is the amplifier module for the tuner. And this is the amplifier for the turntable. And the turntable is actually over here. And when I first got it, the biggest problem was that the tuner amplifier was making a major hum. And this next video clip will show what I'm talking about. It was there all the time, no matter what the settings were. Now, I mentioned that it was the tuner amplifier making that hum. How did I know that? Well, interestingly, when I first got to this, these three speakers over here were connected to the tuner amplifier, and these three speakers were connected to the turntable amplifier. It was connected in a strange sort of way, and I think it was because, like I said before, it was a prototype, and it was really for demonstration purposes. Anytime this thing was hooked up to any speakers, that you'd hear that buzz. Although the turntable amplifier seemed to work pretty well. So I got into it, and I'll show you what I found. After taking off the knobs in the front and disconnecting all the wires, removing the tuner module is not terribly difficult. The hardest part is right about here, where you have to rotate it back in order to clear that right there. Isn't that nice looking? I really like it. Now, since the whole time I wasn't working on the top nearly as much as I was the bottom, I had to figure out a way to set this down upside down. What I did is made this little rack. It's just a piece of wood, and you don't really even have to make it all that sturdy, because once you set it on here, kind of holds itself in place. Just got to get it lined up in there. There we go, just like that. Set the transformer on there. You're ready to work.
Standard operating procedure on old electronics like these is to change out the electrolytic capacitors, because after a few decades, the electrolyte evaporates and those capacitors just don't work very well. Those brown and red cylinders you see in there, those are the ones I'm talking about. So I changed them out. You can see the yellow ones there. That's the after picture. There's before, after, before, after. I think you get the idea, but notice in the center, there's something missing. What's that giant hole right there? That wasn't there before. Well, turning it over, you see that bright shiny cylinder? That is a four-chamber capacitor used for filtering power. And that is the source of our hum. That thing doesn't work anymore. This is the underside of it. You see that junk leaking out the bottom of it? That's not good.
Fortunately for us, all these capacitors are still readily available. I ordered this one from Amplified Parts. It was almost exactly like the one that was there before. It was one of the four chambers that was different, and I had to augment it with a second capacitor inside, but It worked fine, and now there is no hum coming through this module anymore, which is wonderful. Amazingly, every single one of these tubes was okay. I think this was serviced at some point, probably in the 70s or 80s, and has not seen much use since then, so these are all working great. In that previous photo, you might have noticed there was a large cylindrical thing right here. That was a capacitor, a big old capacitor that somebody had added onto the main output signal. I'm thinking they were trying to get rid of the hum, and that was not the way to do it. Obviously, it was still there. So I got rid of that, and I've noticed no adverse effects. In fact, it sounds really good. A few other things I did. This pair of white wires along here, this is the main power coming from the plug to the machine. Now before, that was a pair of green conductors, very similar to these, and they were actually wrapped up with these. These are signal conductors, and that's strange in and of itself, because green is usually used for grounding. But I left those as is. There are two signal pathways through here. This yellow pathway comes along and goes through the switch here, then to the output. And then there's a green one as well. Now, my first thought was that it was left and right speakers. Interestingly, this is a single channel amplifier. There is no left and right. It is mono. So why are there two channels? You have one output tube for the woofer and mid-range, and another output tube for the tweeter only. And that's part of the thing that I think made Curtis Mathes stereo systems sound better than most. They separated that tweeter channel out, and they got a lot better of both ranges by doing so. Naturally, I left it as such. Couldn't really do anything to add stereo to it. It would have completely... it's just not possible with this architecture. But it's sounding great now. Pretty much the only capacitor I left in was this one right here, because it actually works great, and it's hard to find a replacement. So all capacitors replaced, and I'll get to this little red circuit here in just a few minutes. I mentioned earlier when I first got hold of this thing, these three speakers on this side were driven by the tuner amplifier, and these three were driven by the phonograph amplifier. By the way, I didn't have to do any major work to this thing at all. I replaced one single capacitor, and everything else in there was working just fantastic. So I left it alone mostly. I say mostly because this is also, interestingly, only a mono amplifier. It doesn't have two channels coming out of it. It has one single channel, and that channel was originally driving these three speakers. Interestingly, it's got two channels going in from the record player, left and right, and they're summed together to form mono output. The needle for the record player is stereo, the output for the record player is stereo, but the amplifier is mono. This is, I think, just another example of how this was a prototype, not really meant for sale or public use. But that's okay. It sounds really good. What I did was to take the mono signal from this, and instead of driving these three speakers and having those three speakers driven separately, I decided to put all the speakers together as one signal, one mono signal, and have the switch, I modified the switch so that when you're running the radio drives all six speakers, and when you're running the phonograph, that drives all six speakers. That was kind of tough to do. I'll show you what I did. Back over here at the radio module, this thing was designed to take the signal from the record player. It would come in here, go into the module, be amplified, and go out to the speakers. Trouble is, the tone was not very good. The signal that came in from the record player was not amplified, and it was pretty weak, and it just didn't sound very good. It sounded much better when it was coming out of the record player module. So I rigged up a situation. I won't go too deep into the details, but essentially this wire comes out of the record player, comes in here. There's a little switch here that's activated when I flip over to the record player, and it takes the speakers off of this module and connects them to this wire. So when it's on FM, the switch is off and the FM module here, the FM radio module, drives the speakers. When I flip it over to here, the switch turns on, flips over to the record player, and then the record player module drives the speakers. And it works quite well. I'm quite happy with the way it sounds. As you can see, I've got it all put back together again. Now, earlier I mentioned these three speakers were being driven by the phonograph portion, and the other three are being driven by this tuner portion. I had to do some clever rewiring to get it so that the resistances weren't completely out of whack. So right now these four are together wired in sort of a combination series parallel. It brings the overall resistance to about 6 ohms, and the other two are both 8 ohm speakers, and they're wired in parallel for 4 ohms, which is a little low, but within the capability of both of these units to drive them. So it sounds pretty good. All right, let's take a look at the phonograph, beautifully hidden within the furniture. I love that, so 50s. This phonograph was actually working pretty well. There was part of the mechanism that had some portions of it that were gummed up, just needed some cleaning. This phonograph is of the exact same design as a Zenith Cobra-matic. So fortunately, I was able to get the mechanical specs and get that fixed pretty well. It's aesthetically a little different on the outside, but the mechanics are identical. So if you have one of these things, look for the Zenith Cobra-matic service manual and you should be able to work on it. Got some chubby checker playing here, sounding real good. I'm gonna take you to the front of this and show you something interesting. Okay, the controls have some portions of them that are a little odd. It says stereo monaural. This is not stereo, that's not even an option. Has loudness on off. That's just loudness, not on off. Then you got treble and bass, which are exactly what they say they are. But this is just a further indication that this whole setup here is not really designed to be this setup. They were taking parts from other modules and things and putting them together for this whole prototype here. So even though it's a stereo monaural, didn't really do anything. And this on-off here, the on-off is controlled by the record player. If I hit reject, it'll lift the needle up. And at that point, the amplifier itself turns off. So another little interesting thing about this particular one-off interesting Curtis Mathes unit. Couple more kind of interesting things about this particular unit. This, where it says Mathes HiFi here and on the radio, that's quite unusual. Best I can tell, Curtis Mathes was thinking of doing some upscale branding and think they're considering dropping the Curtis portion for a certain line here. Obviously that didn't happen. But it's just an interesting piece of the history of this brand that there exists this unit that says Mathes without the Curtis anywhere on it. There's some other interesting things here. The on-off portion of this is on the bass knob. It's a little unusual. It's on right now. And so there's off and on. Treble's treble only. Tuning, of course, is tuning. Then you got your old 78 hi-fi. Hi-fi is the phonograph, AM/FM and auxiliary. Auxiliary is, there's a plug back in there. You could plug something in there, but it doesn't sound very good, so there's nothing plugged in there. And of course, loudness, not volume, loudness. Love it. That's it, everybody. you listen to some Bo Diddley on the way out here. Thanks for watching. And thanks to my friends Jessica and Danny for letting me work on their really, really cool Mathes HiFi here. Keep on rocking.